evening and welcome to another edition of Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh. Several years ago, I had our guest on, Dr. Ravi Ganta with Digestive Disease Associates, and we talked about a very common gastrointestinal illness called irritable bowel syndrome. Very common, affects millions of people, causing all kinds of symptoms. And at the time, we mentioned a very other common illness called celiac disease, also called gluten enteropathy. Tonight, we're going to talk about celiac disease and gluten disease, sprue, how common it is, and signs and symptoms, and how to test for it. So if you have any questions or comments regarding this, our number is 610-378-0426. Again, 610-378-0426, talking about celiac disease. And I want to introduce my guest, Dr. Ravi Ganta, is a gastroenterologist here in Reading with Digestive Disease Associates. And Ravi, thanks again for being here.
Thanks.
On a warm summer night and taking up time to be here. We were talking how busy you and your practice are, so I know it's very appreciative that you're here.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
We're hearing so much about celiac disease. In fact, you can't almost go to a restaurant now, or certainly a grocery store, and not see gluten-free on the menu. And we're going to talk a little bit about what that means. But it really, in a snapshot, what is celiac disease when people talk about that?
Yeah, celiac disease is an autoimmune disease in which you have antibodies that destroy certain parts of your small intestine. There's something called villi in your small intestine, which are involved in the absorption of nutrients. And when these villi get destroyed, it causes a lot of GI symptoms. It can be very severe and cause someone to be very malnourished at times.
So with these, the villi in the small intestine, if people remember from middle school, hey, those are the little finger-looking things that absorb nutrients. So when your body is making antibodies, making proteins, attacking itself, and the villi don't do their job of absorbing nutrients, what are some of the symptoms people can get?
Yeah, the presentation of celiac disease can be very variable. The classic symptoms include abdominal pain, diarrhea, nausea, but could it be as simple as something like bloating or a little bit of indigestion? The key thing is that these symptoms can be so variable that it has to always be on our radar as a potential diagnosis in someone who has various GI symptoms.
Now, like you said, those symptoms can be vague and they could mimic anything. I mean, boy, who hasn't had some of those symptoms at some times? What are some of the symptoms that over the years you've seen people with celiac disease present with where, you know, you even as a gastroenterologist said, oh my goodness, I can't believe this was celiac?
Yeah, some of the real tricky ones are the ones that they just have a little bit of burping or belching. They complain of something as simple as that. Or some patients who complain of even constipation. We are classically taught that celiac disease is a malabsorption problem and you have diarrhea. No, not always. Sometimes you can go down the wrong path. You start thinking that celiac disease is in someone who has, you know, who's very underweight. I have patients who've had bariatric surgery and they had celiac disease. So you really can't go down the classic picture of celiac disease. It can vary so significantly in each patient.
Now, if people are not absorbing their nutrients, they can become anemic and basically low blood counts. Do you see people who have things like fatigue or other kind of what people call constitutional symptoms like that?
Oh, absolutely. Fatigue, generalized weakness, change in mental status, very vague symptoms like that can be the only presenting symptom.
Oh, goodness. And when people start getting these symptoms, you know, one thing we're going to talk about in a few minutes is the diagnosis of celiac disease and how we make that diagnosis. And one of the challenges is, you know, goodness, those symptoms, we've all been tired, we've all had a bellyache, but we shouldn't all be tested. How do you decide who should get testing versus who shouldn't?
Yeah, it's very tough to say. Sometimes if you present to your family doctor, sometimes the family doctor is the gatekeeper. They may find certain lab abnormalities. You can't generally test everybody because it's not the type of disease where we are screening for them in asymptomatic patients, you know, with fatigue being so common. It's hard to say whether we should test that. Now, if the fatigue is extreme, then we should definitely look into other things, but not as a primary disease to look at.
Okay, so I guess if someone has, let's say, low blood count, anemia, and we don't have a good cause for it, maybe we should think about looking for celiac or other things. But aside from that, not everyone with just one bout of diarrhea per se should get it.
Right, right.
And of course, by the time they end up seeing a gastroenterologist for some of these symptoms, they probably will get tested because their symptoms are probably that severe at that point.
Yes, absolutely. I think that nowadays, with celiac disease being so common, it's almost always on our differential whenever we have a patient coming in with certain symptoms. I can tell you for myself, even with my partners in my practice, celiac disease is almost always a consideration. May not be high always, but we always consider it as a potential diagnosis.
Now, with all those symptoms that people can get, what are some of the other diseases out there, entities that can cause some of those symptoms? In other words, when someone shows up in your office and, you know, as the family doctor, I may say, hey Ravi, hey Dr. Ganta, I'm wondering if this patient has celiac disease. What are the other diagnoses you're considering as well?
It's a very good question. I think one of the big things we find out today is that patients who we have labeled as irritable bowel syndrome, they are now being found out that they have celiac disease. So there's a delay of diagnosis on average of almost 7 to 11 years.
Oh my goodness.
So these patients are coming in, I have a diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome, I almost always will test them for celiac disease because it was not on our radar 10, 15 years ago as it is now.
So that's an important take-home message, that if someone has irritable bowel or has been labeled as irritable bowel, if they haven't been checked for celiac, they probably should, because like you said, it wasn't on our radar in the past couple of years. I think we should make clear, it doesn't mean that a doctor missed it, it just wasn't common to think of then.
Absolutely. I mean, that's the big thing. You know, it's not that the doctor missed it, but it wasn't in a situation where we believe that celiac was that as common as it is now. The testing is better now. We are more aware of it and realizing that, you know, even patients who come in to me with irritable bowel syndrome, I always try to make sure, have they been tested for celiac disease? So even I may step back a bit and try to reanalyze things in patients who have been diagnosed with that.
Are there other diseases or entities that you consider? Do you want to, let's talk a little bit about some of the what are called inflammatory bowel disorders that you may consider with some of these symptoms.
Yes, I mean, certain diseases like Crohn's disease, which affects the small bowel, just like celiac disease affects the small bowel, can present very similarly. There's other conditions like even something as simple as lactose intolerance. You know, lactose intolerance is often mistaken, and they may be labeled with lactose intolerance, but really they have celiac disease. You know, that's the tricky part of this diagnosis. If it's not on your radar, it's not going to be picked up. One of the big things I like to stress is that this is one of the most underdiagnosed conditions when really it shouldn't be, because now it's something so common.
And actually, I have some slides. If you want to put up our first slide here, this alludes to exactly what you were just talking about here, some of the statistics about it. And, you know, when I was preparing for the show tonight, I hadn't realized how common these things are. And at least what I found in the background, that there's over 2 million people affected. And this is amazing. One in 133 Americans. So think of all the people walking around in Berks County, all the patients I see in my office, and 97% go undiagnosed. So the vast majority of people who have this, we're missing. Why is that? I mean, that seems to me like, gosh, if someone had all these symptoms, we should be able to catch it. Why are we missing so much of this?
Right. The big problem is that it's not on the radar of many doctors. They think it's something as simple as indigestion, we'll treat it, and they may get better with that simple treatment. But really, the big thing is awareness. We're getting better at it now compared to before, but clearly we're not testing as much as we should. The Europeans are actually far ahead of us when it comes to that, partly because it was a disease originally thought of for patients who are of Northern European ancestry. Now we're starting to realize that it can affect any patient of any age, gender, or ethnicity.
And there's a genetic component to this?
Yes, there's a genetic component to it. There are certain genes, there are certain markers that we can, in fact, test for now much easier than we once could. And patients who have these particular genes, there's two genes in particular, and I'm not going to go into too much detail on that, but there's two genes. You know, if you have one or two, you know, your risk of the disease goes up much higher. If you have none of those genes, then the risk is very, very low.
And we're talking a little bit about the symptoms, and how is it tested? And you and I were talking before that nowadays there's some really good blood tests out there that are pretty helpful in making the diagnosis. Can you talk a little bit about some of these tests that are out there?
Yes. There are several antibodies which are easily available commercially. We can order it from our own office. There are certain markers called antibodies. There's one called anti-TTG and anti-endomysial antibody. These are the ones that have been shown, if they were positive, the sensitivity and specificity of having this disease is extremely high. Now, once you have markers that are positive, you can't make a diagnosis based on blood tests alone. You should be referred to have what's called an upper endoscopy, and at that time, small bowel biopsies will need to be obtained. The gold standard in the diagnosis is biopsies of the small intestine that show changes in the lining of the small bowel lining. And that's how you make a diagnosis, not by labs alone, which is a mistake if that's okay. The case.
Now, if someone gets these blood tests and they're negative, does that pretty much exclude the diagnosis?
No, that's also a mistake. Remember, okay. these markers are not 100%. There's still a sensitivity of 90 to 95%, but there's a small percent, 5 to 10%, which will be missing. Now, in that case, if your suspicion is still high, I generally would strongly recommend going ahead with an endoscopy, with biopsies.
And the endoscopy, a little more invasive. That's the procedure that gastroenterologists, for example, would do, where the patient's sedated and a little TV camera's inserted, and you can get actually see the small intestine lining.
Absolutely. In fact, when we do these endoscopies, it's about a 15-minute procedure. You know, you'll be sedated. We go in and look inside your small intestine, and you can actually see the villi, the hair-like structures. If we squirt water onto the lining, you can actually see this peach fuzz-looking material. Cool. In general, when we see that, you know, they probably don't have celiac, but there's microscopic changes sometimes underneath the surface. So something may look normal, but they may actually have microscopic changes underneath the surface that indicate early disease.
So it sounds like it's so many things in medicine that it's not an all or nothing, that as clinicians we have to put together the pieces. Does their history sound like it? Do some of the initial labs look like it? These antibody tests, these blood tests we do, may really point in that direction, but then we confirm it with this biopsy and put the pieces together.
Absolutely, because you know, you really don't want to put someone on a strict gluten-free diet, which is the treatment of this condition, without knowing that this is the actual diagnosis you're treating, because it's life-altering.
Now, is there any issues, and one thing you and I were talking about before we started the show, was actually sort of insurance coverages, and you know, one of the challenges is almost playing the games. I had mentioned that there was a case of someone who had some symptoms, and we were trying to figure out how to get the testing covered. I imagine by the time they get to you, it's not as much of an issue, but have you had challenges along those, or not as much by the time they get to you?
Yeah, no, by the time they come to me as a specialist, it's a little different, because the family doctors are really good at sort of doing the initial testing, and then by the time they get to me, I usually have no problems getting these tests covered.
Okay.
Because at that point, they've exhausted all the other diagnoses, and now this is one where it's higher in our evaluation process.
So if someone has these symptoms, it's reasonable to start off talking to their regular doctor, their primary care doctor, looking for other causes, some of the very common things, irritable bowel, lactose intolerance, and doing some tests for celiac if the symptoms warrant. And certainly if these blood tests are positive, they really should be seeing a gastroenterologist for these confirmatory tests.
Absolutely. I think the gatekeepers are the family doctors. They're so important in this whole thing. Because if the family doctor is not aware of this particular condition, they really won't be checking
the
antibodies.
It's not on the radar.
It's not on the radar, and then they'll never get to a level of a gastroenterologist who will then do the gold standard of diagnosis.
Okay, great. Well, we're going to take a short break, and we'll be back in a moment with more Medicine in the News.
You're watching Medicine in the News on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information about your community and other health-related stories, go to bctv.org. Medicine in the News on bctv.org is underwritten by the Reading Hospital and Medical Center. For more information on how you and your business can become a program underwriter, go to bctv.org.
Welcome back to Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh. With me this evening is Dr. Ravi Ganta, gastroenterologist with Digestive Disease Associates. We're talking this evening about celiac disease, sprue, which is so common. If you have any questions or comments, please call at 610-378-0426, and we'll put that number on the screen. Before the break, we were talking about how this is so common and the symptoms can be so varied, and making the diagnosis is so important. Let's talk a little bit about treatment options, and I guess let's be frank, in 2011, there's not a cure for this.
That's exactly right, Lee. The treatment really is a gluten-free diet, a strict gluten-free diet. If you get diagnosed with this condition, it's not that you can have a diet with gluten one day and not the other. Really, 99% of patients who have this disease, they will respond well to a gluten-free diet. There's a select number of patients who, unfortunately, despite doing the strict gluten-free diet, they still have an autoimmune response to their small intestine, and they have terrific symptoms, which are life debilitating. And that, those rare cases, they require immune-suppressing drugs to suppress that immune response to the GI tract. But that's more the exception than the rule. This is a disease which it can be treated by a diet alone 99% of the time.
Which is really amazing. And if we can put up a slide here about gluten. Gluten is really a protein that's found in a lot of, we think of them as breads and other things. But basically, patients really need to eliminate all wheat, rye, barley, anything related to them, to wheat, rye, and barley. And it could take months for the intestine to heal. And in a couple moments, we'll talk about the foods that need to be avoided. And just when I was preparing for this, seeing the list of foods, it's unyielding how many foods contain this protein gluten. How do patients react when you tell them this?
Yes, at first it's a shock because it's a major life-changing event. With this diagnosis, it really can adversely affect the patient because patients may not be able to enjoy the foods that they normally like to enjoy because it'll cause them to have symptoms. One of the advantages now, as opposed to, say, 10 or 15 years ago, is that there's more awareness of this disease. So even the more mainstream grocery stores or restaurants, they do have a gluten-free menu. So it wasn't like 10 or 15 years ago where these patients were very handicapped to a degree. They couldn't even leave their home without bringing their own food. So this is where, awareness has helped these patients. And it's much better to have celiac disease now than 15 years ago, I can tell you that.
Because of that. And the way this sounds is gluten really, it's really like an allergic disease that if you're exposed to it, you can get the symptoms. Now, and preparing for this, it sounds like it could take months for the intestine to heal from all the inflammation and problems. Have you seen dramatic results? I mean, do you see patients where they're coming to you bloated and have all these symptoms and 6 months later they feel better?
Oh my goodness, yes. It's amazing. When they go on a gluten-free diet, when they get this diagnosis, I would say most of my patients have remarkable improvement. Traditionally speaking, they get symptomatic improvement, but in addition to that, their labs get better. And when we re-biopsy their small intestine, remarkably after a year or less than that, the villi, those hair-like structures which were once flattened, they grow back looking to normal.
So they could absorb nutrients.
They could absorb nutrients. And sometimes these celiac patients who have lost tremendous amounts of weight, they actually gain their weight back because now they're absorbing those nutrients that they were not absorbing before.
Are there any challenges with that? Because, in other words, if a patient does great on a gluten-free diet and then they accidentally have a piece of bread or something else, do they have a setback for months, or is it, how does it work? In other words, like you said, can some patients get away with a little once in a while, or is it not that type of thing?
No, that's an interesting question. They've done studies on that where there are certain patients who can get away with a certain amount of gluten in their diet, but there's other patients who even a little speckle of gluten will cause them to get into a violent reaction. It won't necessarily set them back for months. A person who will have dramatic changes in their biopsies and their symptoms long term will be someone who's taking it inadvertently on a more consistent basis, or they're taking it purposefully and they realize that they can handle the symptoms.
And what have you found locally with regard to children? Because we talked about this before, that your scope of practice, you're not a pediatric gastroenterologist, but are you finding from your patients and families in general that schools, are they becoming more aware of this? And I guess it has to do with our awareness in general?
Yes. Now we are educating schools about this because this is a disease that can present at any point in life. It can present when you're very young, and then at that point you get used to doing a new lifestyle. But schools are the perfect target because there are many kids who present in their elementary years, and without educating them, the cafeterias and and the environment they're in, it won't be conducive for them to have a good learning environment. So even schools are offering gluten-free options.
And it's interesting in preparing for this, I found that children also present not only with the classic symptoms of the bloating, but can have very non-specific symptoms of irritability. And, you know, again, it's just worth talking to your doctor. If we could put up a slide, let's go over some of the foods, and this is a huge list, and obviously there's a ton out there on the internet and everywhere else, and of course patients with celiac are experts in this because they live this, but barley, bran, farina, rye, wheat bran, just so many things, certain flours, orzo, so many things have gluten, and in fact some others, ales, beers, certain soups and candies, certain French fries, lunch meats, hot dogs. Again, we often think of gluten as being just in a piece of bread, but everything in Play-Doh, I saw surprisingly certain lip gloss, lipsticks, vitamins, over-the-counter supplements. You know, this is just, it can be quite overwhelming. But then there's some gluten-free grains and starches that people can try, certain rices, certain flax, corn, potato starches, soy. So at least now there are options, and of course more and more with our country and food labeling, it's we're getting better at that. Have you found any patients or any cases where people have had some good tips, or what do people do to help them get through this? Do they carry around these lists in grocery stores, or what happens?
No, it's amazing actually. My patients are actually better than me at telling which foods they can take and what they can't take. We have these beautiful lists of things, but they know which ones actually they can tolerate and which they can't. They don't necessarily carry lists. Maybe in the beginning they do, but they can tell you right away where they can go to eat and where they can't go. And at the grocery store, they know which stores sell the foods they can eat. So it's so variable. Some patients can tolerate certain foods that the next celiac patient cannot. Going to a different point now too is that gluten-free has become sort of like a fad diet amongst many patients. You see a lot of health places, really push a gluten-free diet, really saying, "Oh, this is the new lifestyle." But it's fine, dandy, but it's a tough diet to really follow, and it actually doesn't really do justice for the patients who really have celiac disease, who need to be on a strict diet, and it's not an option for them. A lot of patients come to me; they may actually start the gluten-free diet on by themselves, and thinking that they have celiac disease without being tested. Unfortunately, when they do come to me on a gluten-free diet, I tell them, I can't test you because the labs and the biopsies will be normal. So I actually tell them, get back to a regular diet.
Okay, so that way you can make the diagnosis. Right. And you had mentioned before that we're finding a little bit of a gray zone where some people may be very sensitive to gluten, yet on all the tests for celiac disease, those may be negative. So where are we heading with that? Is there such a thing then as gluten sensitivity, but they're not, they don't have true celiac disease?
Yes, this is a very interesting area, and it's, as we mentioned, a gray zone, because these are patients who, I didn't believe it myself until I had a couple patients who had to go through this, where they have classic symptoms of celiac disease, but we biopsy them, they don't have the findings on pathology, they don't have the labs to suggest it, but they clearly, when they go on a gluten-free diet, all their symptoms resolve. And at first I thought maybe it's just because, more of a placebo effect. But I realize now that there's more to it than that, and that there is a condition called gluten sensitivity. Whether this is a situation where they're in the early stages of actually manifesting the disease, maybe if we biopsy them 5 years from now, they'll have full-blown disease, that's a possibility. Some people think this is a spectrum.
Okay, so again, we're catching it earlier.
Catching it earlier,
again,
correct.
Getting the word out, and like I mentioned to you, I now have patients asking me to get tested, and which is very different from 5, certainly 10 years ago, given the awareness out there. Is there anything on the horizon with regard to this? Is there any magic bullets coming? Or it sounds in some ways that it's so fundamental in the genetics that gluten is so prevalent. It sounds like it's very challenging that the treatment options are coming in dietary therapies.
Yes, because it's a disease that is well treated with a gluten-free diet, interestingly, the pharmaceutical industry is not so enthused about doing research because there's not much opportunity for them to develop a new drug to necessarily make their life better. But there are some studies to show that they're going to develop some medications perhaps to try to block the immune response in a more safe fashion than the typical immune suppressive drugs. But once again, this is far down the horizon, and my feeling is that if a gluten-free diet works, that's probably the safest investing.
Sure. And is there, we only have just a few moments left, is there any associations of celiac disease with certain cancers? There's been some talk about that.
Yes, that's an excellent point I'd like to stress. This is not just a disease of symptoms. You know, when you have a diagnosis of celiac disease, you may have symptoms, but we're not here to treat just your symptoms, but also to decrease the risk of cancers. In particular, the small intestine is at high risk of developing certain cancers called lymphoma or adenocarcinoma. And believe it or not, it can affect other parts of the GI tract that may not be involved with celiac disease. For example, patients with celiac disease are at higher risk for esophageal cancer, believe it or not. So these are real things.
So if we find this, not only do we do the gluten-free diet and make them feel better, of course, but also really look more thoroughly and closely for cancers to make sure they don't develop.
Right. So doing the gluten-free diet, what I tell my patients, is not just to help with your symptoms, because there are some patients who say, well, let me go and eat a regular meal because I can tolerate the symptoms for a day or two. I tell them it's not so much the symptoms. Worry about the long-term manifestations, which is the increased risk of worsening disease, but also the risk of the cancer.
Right, and I think we're just about out of time, but really it's been the take-home message with celiac, by and large, sounds like to consider it, to think about it, because it is so prevalent. So tonight on Medicine in the News, we've been talking about celiac disease, sprue, which is so common. My guest has been Dr. Ravi Ganta at Digestive Disease Associates. And Ravi, again, I very much appreciate you coming on here. We'll have to now get you back about lactose intolerance and all these other issues and illnesses that come up. If you have any questions or concerns, comments on tonight's programs, or thoughts for upcoming programs, please just contact me via phone or email, and we'll put that up at the end of the show. So this has been Medicine in the News. Thanks, and good evening.